1945. Enemy's mechanical power is overwhelming us. But has the last word been said? Shall hope leave us? Is the defeat final? No, it isn't. Believe me, nothing is lost for France. This country is not alone. A vast empire is with us. We'll make a bloc with the British Empire, carrying on the struggle together. This war wasn't settled by the Battle of France. This is a world war. The flame of French resistance shall not be extinguished. This appeal from Charles de Gaulle to the French people was broadcast on the 18th of June, 1940 from the BBC. Charles de Gaulle, a man who for a period represented France and its honor, his message of the 18th of June is a historical milestone. It struck us for its foresight, having been pronounced when the overpowering Nazi forces seemed to leave no margin for hope. Charles de Gaulle was born at Lille on the 22nd of November, 1890. He soon leaves for Paris, where his father Henry is a teacher at the Jesuits' Immaculate Conception College. In 1912, he graduates from the Saint-Cyr Military Academy, holding the rank of second lieutenant. He enters the 33rd Infantry Regiment at the orders of Colonel Pétain, the man who, in 1940, will become his opponent. During the First World War, he is wounded twice and taken prisoner at Verdun. He tries to escape several times, but is shut in a concentration camp till the end of the war. As a prisoner, he meets Tukhachevsky, then only a subaltern of the Russian army, and later its theorist and organizer. At the end of the war, he is appointed professor of history at the Saint-Cyr Academy. He writes a number of essays setting forth his theories on modern war, theories mostly disapproved of by the army's high commanders. France, in order to contain Germany's military power, builds up the Maginot Line, a system of fortifications with dome-shaped steel protections and artillery at a distance of 4 to 6 kilometers. The Maginot Line, uncovered for only 30 kilometers towards the Belgian border, runs with no interruption for 400 kilometers. The War Council, having recognized the soundness of de Gaulle's theories on armored corps, assigns him the command of a tanks regiment. As the years go by, strong governments are established in Italy, Germany, and Spain. A difficult period of concessions to Hitler and Mussolini is beginning for Europe. France wants peace, but it has to submit to Hitler's arrogance. Germany annexes the Rhineland, Austria, and part of Czechoslovakia. In September 1939, France itself has neither the means nor the will to face German power. De Gaulle writes in a memo to Premier Daladier, German aviation and tanks defeated Poland in 2 weeks. France is defenseless. Nothing could be done to defend Poland. Nothing can be done now, in spite of British help. After invading Holland, Luxembourg, and Belgium, the Germans are heading straight on to Paris and to the Channel. The Panzer Armored Division's assaults by land and the Stukas' severe attacks by air will be decisive. War breaks out with terrifying violence on all the French territories. General Végan, the army's commander-in-chief, tries to offer resistance, but the French front is defeated. The German troops occupy Paris. Maréchal Pétain, in a heartbroken speech beginning with these dramatic words, "Peoples of the world, France is wounded," asks for an armistice. In a fortnight's time, France loses 15 divisions, and Britain has to withdraw its army at Dunkirk. Marechal Pétain assumes power, and he gives in to the Germans. Hitler's army occupies Paris. 50-year-old General de Gaulle doesn't surrender. He flies to London, where on the 18th of June 1940, he launches his famous appeal to the French people. For his appeal, General de Gaulle is denied French citizenship by Marechal Pétain and sentenced to death. But he continues his struggle from abroad under the symbol of the Cross of Lorraine. In France, the resistance is being organized. A small French army is formed first in Great Britain and then in North Africa. The United States enters the war. President Roosevelt doesn't like Charles de Gaulle very much and advises him of the Allies landing in France only on the eve of it. Anyway, the general is one of the first to get to Africa and to decorate the scanty colonial troops in the name of France, existing only in his hopes. The Allied troops free North Africa, and at Algiers, another Frenchman is appointed by Mr. Roosevelt to represent France. At the Casablanca meeting called by the American president, de Gaulle declares that he won't share with anybody his role of chief of free France, and in CNL, which is formed at Algiers, General Giraud is rapidly made powerless. On the 6th of June 1944, the Allies land in Normandy, while difficulties arise between de Gaulle, Churchill, and Roosevelt over the procedure for France's liberation. De Gaulle is worrying about his return home and the way the French will receive him. But when he arrives in France on the 14th of June 1944, all the country is with him. He is not anymore the almost unknown general who left 4 years before on a small aircraft, but he's the savior of France's honor. Paris is rebelling, and the Germans are driven out by the Leclerc division. The war is turning to the Allies' advantage, but General de Gaulle is not regarded highly by the Americans, while Stalin considers him a political opponent, and Churchill sees France as a future rival in Europe. De Gaulle is not invited to the Yalta and Tehran conferences. On both occasions, Churchill will be France's spokesman. On the 25th of June 1944, de Gaulle enters the capital. Along the Champs-Élysées, the crowd is wild with happiness for the liberation. Goes to Moscow, where he ratifies with Stalin an alliance similar to that drawn up by Great Britain and France. The war ends and France celebrates a victory which was made possible by General de Gaulle. But once again, the general is excluded from a peace conference. He is not invited to the Potsdam meeting. France is assigned an occupation area in Germany, as Churchill had decided at the Yalta conference. On the 21st of October, 96% of the French people choose by referendum a new constitution. It is the Fourth Republic. A unanimous vote appoints de Gaulle president of the provisional government. Later, at the first political elections, the parties are once again one against the other to get the power. deeply divided by internal disputes. To tackle the difficult situation, the only alternative for de Gaulle besides dictatorship is to retire to Colombey-les-Deux-Églises, a small village 250 kilometers from Paris. The Fourth Republic has a difficult life, one government crisis after another. De Gaulle's political opponents begin to partly agree with his ideas. Mendes France, his greatest antagonist, fights against the European Defense Community and votes against the European Common Market. Guy Mollet invests what should be the French contribution to NATO in the Suez Venture of 1956 and in the Algerian War. On the 13th of May 1958, Algiers rebels and a government crisis breaks out, though it is somehow soon resolved. At Algiers, the new government is suspected of negotiating with the rebels. Monsieur Coty, the French president, receives a threatening cable from General Massu. It's the revolt of the army generals. Algiers demands a public safety government. Actually, it's the French people who, tired of a long period of political insecurity and worried by the Algerian War, wants General de Gaulle back to power. Algeria is leading France to sedition. Risk of a civil war is now real. General Salon, the army commander-in-chief, ends a speech in Algiers with a hooray for Charles de Gaulle, who, speaking to about 100 journalists in a Paris hotel, declares, "I am ready to assume the Republican powers." The general's rebellion in Algeria is getting stronger. A portrait of General de Gaulle appears on the government building facade. The French government is now almost powerless. On the 27th of May 1958, 50,000 people demonstrate in Paris against General de Gaulle, who announces his will to establish a Republican government. The Fourth Republic is dying, and President Coty calls de Gaulle to the Élysée, where he enters by the cock's door, the one reserved for monarchs. De Gaulle asks the Parliament for full powers, obtaining 329 votes of confidence against 224. The Fifth Republic is born. General de Gaulle acts more like a monarch than a president. He assumes all powers and leaves to the parties, the press, and the unions the role of spectators. The Algerian problem, after rebellions, mutinies, barricades, is at last settled on the 18th of March 1962 at Evian, where the armistice between the French and the provisional Algerian government is signed. France is trying hard to join the group of the great nations. After a century of conflict with the Germans, de Gaulle goes to West Germany, meeting several times with Mr. Adenauer. With him on the 20th of January 1963, he signs at the Élysée the Anglo-German Pact. These are the years of the revival of France's grandeur. De Gaulle dreams of France as one of the great powers, but in the atomic era, nobody is a great power without nuclear weapons. He creates a deterrent so as to free France from US diplomacy and Atlantic obeisance. First, there will be the atomic submarines. Soon after, nuclear plants are established. De Gaulle doesn't miss any opportunity to officially emphasize the importance and prestige of these events. A little later, there will be the explosion of the first French hydrogen bomb in the Sahara. During 10 years, France will have two premiers, and both will be de Gaulle's men, Debray and Pompidou. The parties are losing their character and their importance, but the French are called 10 times to vote during General de Gaulle's leadership. It seems that the French attained what they wanted, political security and a role of importance on the world scene. But something is slowly changing in the country. De Gaulle perhaps misunderstands the problems faced daily by the French. He calls for new elections, raises salaries, promotes a reform of the country's structures. In spite of everything, his popularity wanes. In April 1969, France is against him on a minor issue poll, Senate reform and administrative decentralization. He retires already ill at Colombey-les-Deux-Églises, where he dies on the 9th of November, 1970.
Is destined to dominate the Kremlin for 20 years, Joseph Stalin, is born December 21st, 1879, in Gori, Georgia. At age 18, he joins the Workers' Party and collaborates on the first Marxist paper. Arrested in 1902, he is deported to Siberia. He escapes from Siberia in early 1904 and returns to participate in acts of violence with fellow Bolsheviks. In 1905, he meets Lenin. Stalin is active in the 4th and 5th Congress of the Communist Party. After the defeat of the 1905 revolution, Stalin assumes leadership of the local Bolshevik party in Baku. He is arrested and deported many times, but succeeds each time in escaping. Early in 1913, Stalin begins to use a pseudonym, Man of Steel. After another short imprisonment, he returns to St. Petersburg as a member of the Politburo. Motivated by greed and ambition, Stalin thirsts for power. An intense rivalry develops between Stalin and Trotsky. Trotsky is aware of Stalin's restless pursuit of power and seeks the aid of Lenin. Stalin is elected Secretary General in 1922 and creates a triumvirate with Zinoviev and Kamenev. In 1924, Lenin dies. His will, which is kept secret, denounces Stalin. In full control of the Communist Party, Stalin accuses Trotsky of treason and political insubordination. He effects Trotsky's expulsion from the party and exiles him for life. His political rival out of the way, Stalin reintroduces some of Trotsky's doctrines, such as those of industrialization. Stalin assumes dictatorial powers in 1929 and enforces a rigid police state. As dictator, Stalin initiates a series of purges to eliminate the old guard. Death and deportation are his methods. Stalin's foreign policy appears to oppose fascism. His domestic policy is one of industrialization. These doctrines usher in the Stalin era. In 1936, civil war breaks out in Spain. Accusing foreign powers of weakness against fascism, Stalin supports the existing Spanish government. 2 years later, Stalin reverses his policy and becomes Hitler's ally. At the dawn of World War II, the communists occupy eastern Poland, the Baltic countries, and a part of Finland and Romania. Trotsky continues his fight against Stalin from exile. Stalin seeks to have Trotsky assassinated and finally succeeds August 20th, 1940. On May 6, 1941, Stalin assumes the premiership. On June 22, 1941, he becomes President of National Defense, and 1 month later, he is named Commissar of War. Global war demonstrates a lack of military organization. Initial confusion results. Stalin's reaction is to stimulate patriotism and nationalism. This conduct is calculated to meet the needs of his foreign policy. In 1943, Stalin participates at the Tehran Summit Conference with Roosevelt and Churchill. In 1945, he is again a dominant figure at the Yalta and Potsdam Conferences. At Potsdam, he commits the USSR to join the United States and Great Britain in the war against Japan. After the war, as generalissimo and uncontested leader, Stalin is surrounded by power and becomes a powerful protagonist in the political world. Stalin takes advantage of conflicting attitudes to initiate the Cold War as Russia's political doctrine. He breaks with Yugoslavia and attempts to unite all communists. Internal tension prevails. A need for greater liberalism exists, but Stalin becomes more despotic. Stalin dies March 5th, 1953, of a cerebral hemorrhage at the age of 73. It is only gradually that his domestic and foreign doctrines are relaxed. The effects of one of the most powerful and complex figures in history will still be felt for some time to come. At the 20th Congress of the Communist Party, the emerging leader is Nikita Khrushchev. Now, throughout Russia, begins a period of de-Stalinization. Lev Davidovich Trotsky, real name Bronstein, is born in 1879 near Elizabethgrad, Russia. In 1898, he is arrested for being a revolutionary and exiled to Eastern Siberia. In 1902, he escapes to England by means of a forged passport in the name of Trotsky. He is to use this name henceforward. In London, he meets Lenin, a member of the Social Democrats. Trotsky returns to Russia in 1905 and is elected a member of the Soviet of Workers' Deputies. Again, he is arrested, but escapes immediately upon his arrival in Siberia. He then goes to Vienna, where he works for Pravda, the communist publication. At the beginning of World War I, Trotsky is in Constantinople as a war correspondent. The following year finds him in Switzerland, France, and the United States, aiding in the publication of a revolutionary paper. Back in St. Petersburg in 1917, he joins the revolutionaries and becomes People's Commissar for Foreign Affairs in the new Soviet government. Trotsky figures principally in negotiating the Brest-Litovsk peace treaty with Germany. Despite the treaty, the Germans continue their advance. Lenin accepts the Germans' conditions for peace, and Trotsky is again at Brest-Litovsk to sign the peace treaty. 14 nations rally to create the White Army to fight communism. Civil war explodes violently. The White Army conquers all territory between Moscow and St. Petersburg. Lenin, to face the situation, gives Trotsky command of the Red Army. Aboard an armored train, Trotsky crosses Russia and blocks the rebel army. After 3 years of civil war, Bolshevism triumphs. In 1919, the foundation is laid for the Third Communist Party. In 1920, Trotsky organized the troops not needed for war into labor armies. Trotsky soon loses Lenin's support over economic policies. Lenin is now paralyzed and suffering from apoplexy. As Lenin weakens, Stalin's popularity begins to rise. In 1923, the triumvirate of Stalin, Zinoviev, and Kamenev gained full control of the government and violently opposed Trotsky's position on industrialization and collective farming. Trotsky is not informed of Lenin's death and does not attend the funeral. The older communist leaders seek to keep Trotsky ignorant of all government developments and to discredit him. In his will, Lenin requested the Central Committee to control the rise of Stalin, but this document never comes to light. In 1925, Stalin has a stronghold on the Central Committee, and Trotsky loses his post as Commissar of War. In 1927, he is expelled from the Communist Party for anti-party activities and is exiled to Kazakhstan. Subsequently banished, he goes to Constantinople, where he writes The Permanent Revolution and History of the Russian Revolution. Trotsky continues to seek refuge in various countries. He is repudiated until finally given asylum in France. He spends 2 years in Barbizon until he is expelled. He finds refuge in Norway, where he writes The Revolution Betrayed, The Crimes of Stalin, and other works denouncing Stalinism. Several attempts are made on his life in Norway, and he leaves for Mexico. His home there is perpetually guarded by the Mexican police and private agents. Trotsky continues his fight against Stalinism. He authors the Opposition Bulletin and forms an organization called the Fourth International to unify his followers. The Kremlin sentences Trotsky to death. During his exile in Mexico, several assassination attempts are made. Trotsky expects death at any moment. Each day he tells his wife, "We are blessed with the gift of life for another day." A supposed friend, later described as a Stalinist agent, succeeds in gaining Trotsky's confidence. On August 20th, 1940, in Mexico City, Trotsky is mortally wounded and dies the next day. Thus fell the leading theorist and exponent of communism, a man ever in opposition to the old guard of the Kremlin. In 1889, Adolf Hitler is born in Braunau on the Inn. His father is an Austrian customs employee, his mother a Hausfrau. Orphaned at 17, he goes to Vienna to study painting. He fails twice to secure entry to the Academy of Fine Arts. In Munich in 1913, he works at miscellaneous temporary jobs. At age 24, he joins the Bavarian army and is wounded. Remaining with his regiment for a short while after the war, he soon gains notoriety for his eloquence. As a member of the newly formed Labor Committee, he is given charge of propaganda against communism. In Munich in 1920, he organizes a congress and explains his political views. The next year, he eliminates the head of the National Socialist Party. Hitler exalts nationalism as a solution to widespread hunger and misery. Along with other insurgents, in 1923, he tries but fails to take over the Bavarian government under von Kahr. Hitler is wounded, arrested, and sentenced to 5 years for high treason. In prison, Hitler prepares the first volume of Mein Kampf. Released 9 months later, he creates the SS. He gathers around him several Nazi leaders, notably Himmler, Goering, and Hess. The Wall Street crash precipitates economic and political instability. Failure of the German government to achieve success in internal or external affairs allows the Nazi Party to gain 2 million votes. Hindenburg is recalled from exile, and as president of the Reich in 1931, he offers Hitler a place in the government. Hitler refuses this position and will refuse it again in 1932. In April 1932, Hitler becomes a candidate in the national elections. After an intensive political campaign, he collects 13 million votes. Although insufficient for an election victory, this is the beginning of a political maneuver along with von Papen to gain control of power. Hitler's position is stabilized on June 30th, 1934, during the so-called Night of Long Knives, when his few remaining opponents are eliminated. He assumes the presidency of the Reich when Hindenburg dies. Immediately, Hitler abolishes political parties, centralizes all power, and creates a police force, the Gestapo. Germany is in the throes of Nazism. Hitler, the Führer, enforces his militaristic ideas on the German people. He encourages heavy industry, builds a strong labor force, and begins rearmament. Goebbels, in charge of propaganda, parrots Hitler's ideas on superiority of the German race and persecution of the Jews. Synagogues are destroyed, and Jews are labeled public enemies of the state. Many Jews flee Germany, among them the great physicist Einstein. In March of 1936, Hitler's forces take over the Rhineland. During this year, he also begins an affair with Eva Braun, who will remain with him until death. At the Berlin Olympics, Hitler leaves the stadium each time the American Negro Jesse Owens wins a gold medal, an effrontery to his theory of Aryan white superiority. In October of 1936, Hitler allies with Mussolini, forming the Axis powers. Italian fascists and German soldiers fight side by side with Franco during the Spanish Civil War. Hitler, appearing to fight communism and democracy, makes a pact with Japan to complete the Axis. Under pretext of uniting all German-speaking countries, Hitler annexes Austria in March of 1938, as well as all German minorities in Bohemia. In September 1938, Mussolini goes to Munich to arbitrate between Hitler and the democratic countries. War is averted, but Germany takes over Bohemia, Danzig, and one-fourth of Czechoslovakia. In August 1939, Hitler concludes the Pact of Steel with Italy and a non-aggression pact with Russia. 8 days later, he invades Poland. Thus begins the global war that is to last for 6 years. Using blitzkrieg tactics, Hitler sees victory follow victory. Denmark and Norway fall to Germany. In May 1940, an offensive is launched against Belgium and Holland. A month later, German troops overrun France. Just as the French had humiliated the Germans at the end of World War I, Hitler avenges the Treaty of Versailles by having the French sign terms of surrender in a train at Compiègne. Germany is in a state of exaltation. Hitler takes advantage of his success to reinforce ideas of superiority of the German race and to intensify deportation and extermination of the Jews. On the seas, the German fleet is invincible. By June 1940, Italy has entered the war as Germany's ally. Together in the spring of 1941, the German and Italian armies occupy Yugoslavia and Greece. Although Hitler dominates continental Europe, his thirst for conquest is not satisfied. On June 22, 1941, the German army invades Russia. After a setback near Moscow, Hitler personally assumes supreme command. Despite many German victories, there is bitter resistance in Stalingrad. Defeats are suffered by the Axis, and the tide of war begins to turn against Germany. American and British troops land in Italy. On July 25, 1943, Mussolini is arrested. Italy capitulates and signs an armistice. Hitler stubbornly refuses to recognize that Germany is falling. He attempts to bolster patriotism and morale while the Nazi Party continues its rampage. The number of crematories is increased, and extermination continues at an appalling rate. In the concentration camp of Auschwitz alone, the Nazis eliminate 6,000 Jews per day. This genocide continues until the end of the war, by which time 6 million Jews will have been exterminated. On June 6, 1944, the Allies land in Normandy. The Germans are engaged in two fronts and suffer serious setbacks. On July 20th, 1944, Colonel von Stauffenberg and others try to assassinate Hitler. This attempt fails, and Hitler takes refuge in his bunker. The German army is destroyed. Hitler is forced to call to arms old men and young boys. Hitler's last hope is the use of his secret weapons, the V-1 and V-2 rockets. The Germans cannot stop the American and English troops on the Western Front and the Russian forces on the Eastern Front. Hitler makes a final appearance to the public and withdraws to his bunker for the last time. His two remaining acts are to marry his mistress, Eva Braun, and to name Admiral Dönitz as his successor. Accepting defeat, Hitler makes his farewells to his few remaining followers. On April 30th, 1945, Hitler shoots himself and Eva Braun takes poison. According to his instructions, their bodies are burned.
Benito Mussolini was born in 1883 in Predappio, Italy. Before graduation, barely 17 years old, he joins the Socialist Party. In 1902, to avoid the draft, he goes to Switzerland, where he stays for 2 years. He returns to teach and collaborate with the socialist newspapers of that time. At the age of 26, he is engaged to Rachele Guidi. He will marry in 1915. In 1910, he participates in popular demonstrations, and in December 1912, becomes editor of the Socialist Party's official newspaper, Avanti. At the beginning of the First World War, he assumes a neutral position. Subsequently, he starts a new daily, Il Popolo d'Italia. Expelled from the Socialist Party, he creates the Union of the Revolutionary Action and answers the call to arms. After the war, he returns to Milan as publisher of Il Popolo d'Italia. He entices his followers, as well as students, to take the workers' places during strikes, taking advantage of unrest and the people's discontent with the existing political regime. On the 23rd of March, 1919, in the Piazza San Sepolcro, he creates the first nucleus of the Fascist Party. He expresses his aversion to the democratic institutions, and with the help of industrial capital and good luck, he's elected to the Chamber of Deputies in 1921. In November 1921, he has a mass meeting in Naples. The National Fascist Party of Black Shirts consolidates. Popular acceptance and large followings convince Mussolini he is on the right track to gain absolute power. He marches on Rome the 28th of October, 1922. He arrives in the capital, followed by his fascist followers from every corner of Italy. He gains the support of the army, as well as King Victor Emmanuel III. And on the 30th of October, he is given the order to form a new government. In the beginning, Mussolini is cautious, and he seeks the cooperation of other political parties. Gradually, however, he consolidates his rule under a dictatorship. In January of 1923, he establishes the Gran Consiglio and establishes one Italy with one party. The fascists are in control. Various politicians accept Mussolini's action. Only one opponent, Deputy Giacomo Matteotti, denounces the fascist leader. Matteotti is assassinated the 24th of June, 1924. Still, the various parties are passive to Mussolini's action, and the king reconfirms his trust in Il Duce. With new laws established in 1925 and 1926, the fascist leader gains supreme powers. By the end of 1926, he abolishes all other political parties. He creates a special tribunal as a tool to eradicate all his opponents. In 1929, he creates the bilateral pacts to establish the relation between church and state. Mussolini creates the working card in 1927, which puts the country's economy completely under his control. With his penchant for eloquent speeches, he becomes more and more popular. He travels throughout the country giving speeches, enticing farmers and workers. Mussolini speaking to the workers of Fiat. It has been 10 years since we have seen each other. Now we are united together.
Ma soprattutto non potete vedervi cambiato dal punto di vista morale. Poiché abbiamo delle forze imponenti.
We have the total approval of all the workers of all of Italy. In celebration of these first 10 years, we give birth to the new generation.
Non solo voi, ma tutti. Sono pienamente convinti che questo non è che il primo decennio al quale ne seguiranno perlomeno 9. Viva tutti!
Mussolini congratulates Italo Balbo for the first transatlantic crossing. It's the time of grand speeches and the birth of new cities. He dedicates Littoria. Then in Sardinia, new cities are born, Fertilia, Carbonia, Mussolinia. In foreign affairs, he opposes Hitler's ideas of annexation of Austria. The meeting between the two dictators is cold. Mussolini is on the side of England and France, and with ministers Laval and MacDonald, signs the Pact of Stresa. Driven by his desires to conquer and expand, and encouraged by the condescending attitude of the democratic countries, he prepares to occupy Ethiopia. In October of 1935, he declares war. Mussolini salutes the troops embarking for East Africa. The League of Nations, calling it a war of aggression, imposes economic sanctions against Italy. Mussolini responds, mobilizing the working nation to be self-sufficient. To support the nation's economy, he organizes a national campaign to collect the nation's metals and personal gold. Fortunately, the war is brief. The enemy has not enough arms to oppose a well-equipped army. In 1936, the Italian people gather to hear the victory from Il Duce. Men and women of Italy, Italians and friends of Italy, listen to the telegram from our Marshal Badoglio.
Il maresciallo Badoglio telegrafa. Oggi.
Today, the 5th of May, at 1600 hours, leading our victorious troops, I entered Addis Ababa. Italy has an empire, and Mussolini wants it to be fascist. At this time, the Italian dictatorship comes closer to the German dictatorship of the Führer and sides with him in the Spanish Civil War. Many Italians, opposing fascism, fight on the opposite side. fascism is coming into its own. Hitler, taking advantage of his new alliance during the Spanish Civil War, works hard to cement their relations. There are many exchange visits between the two military leaders. In 1936, Hitler and Mussolini formed the Rome-Berlin Alliance. Later in 1939 in Munich, the Pact of Steel, a strong alliance between Italy and Germany. In 1939, Hitler starts World War II. Mussolini abstains from the conflict, and on September 1st, 1939, declares Italy's neutrality. The rapid victory of the German army over various European nations induces Mussolini to abandon his neutrality. The sudden change in politics leaves Italy confused. On the 10th of June, 1940, Italy declares war. The Italian soldiers, ill-equipped, ill-prepared, and disorganized, begin to suffer early in the conflict. The people don't relish this war. Mussolini tries to rally them with reports of the early Axis victories. The war seems to drag. Germany is suffering defeat on all European fronts, and now faces defeat in Africa. The situation is becoming critical. The fascist party is losing faith in Il Duce. On the 15th of July, 1943, the king orders Mussolini's arrest, and the government is given to Marshal Badoglio. On September 29th, Badoglio's government signs the armistice, and on October 13th, declares war on Germany. Mussolini is imprisoned, first on the island of Ponza, then on the island of Maddalena, finally to Gran Sasso. At Gran Sasso, Mussolini is freed by German paratroopers, and Mussolini is taken to Germany and meets with Hitler. From Germany, Mussolini creates the basis of the Italian Socialist Republic, with its government headquarters at Rocca delle Cavanate near Forli on September 23, 1943. General Graziani is placed in charge of the fascist Republican Army. In Rome, he honors the tomb of the unknown soldier. The Italian flag flies without the emblem of the Royal House of Savoy. At the end of September, the new Republican government moves into northern Italy and intensifies recruiting. Italy is divided. Badoglio's government on the Allies' side, Mussolini's puppet regime on the Axis side. Mussolini tries to revive Italy's old glory. The Nazis impose a dictatorial regime, enforcing obedience by force, extermination, and concentration camps. Partisans against the Nazi fascist regime are mercilessly shot. At the Lyric Theater in Milan, on the 16th of December, 1944, Mussolini delivers one of his last speeches. The Italian people have not betrayed their Axis allies. Again, in Milan, in April, he tries to obtain support. On April 24th, 1945, he's last seen in the courtyard of Milan's police headquarters. He's leaving for Como and refuge in Switzerland. The World War is ending. The partisans are liberating the northern Italian towns as the Allies are defeating the last Nazi defenses. It's the end of Mussolini's Italy and Hitler's Germany. The Allies and partisans destroy all last vestiges of Nazism and fascism. Attempting to flee Italy in disguise, Mussolini and his mistress, Claretta Patacci, are seized by partisans on the 27th of April near the Swiss border. The morning of the 28th of April, the Partisan Liberation Committee shoots them. The bodies of Mussolini, Patacci, and other fascist leaders are brought back and placed on public display in Loreto Square in Milan. Benito Mussolini is dead at 62. Il Duce of the Italian people for over 22 years.